Tradition and excellence have long been hallmarks of the Pitt State football program, and that certainly was the case during the 20-year tenure of former Gorillas head coach Chuck Broyles. Coach Broyles accumulated a record of 198 wins, 47 losses, and two ties in 247 career games as the Gorillas head coach from 1990 to 2009. He averaged nearly 10 wins a season for his entire tenure, when his squads were guaranteed to only play 10 or 11 games a year. Broyles served as defensive coordinator at Pitt State for two seasons, before taking over the Gorilla helm in December 1989, when then head coach Dennis Francione left Pitt State for Southwest Texas State.
I will say this, what a great person, what a great friend, what a great guy to work with and coach with, had the ability to take a serious situation and analyze it and deal with it and then make it light and make it workable. Always a good outlook on things and fun to be around. I know from my coaching career, the time that I was able to spend coaching with Chuck was about as rewarding and a period of time that I talk about a lot with other people because we had so much fun together.
In his first season as head coach in 1990, the former Pitt State All-American led his alma mater to an unblemished regular season, a 12-1 record, and a trip to the NCAA Division II semifinals, where the Gorillas fell in a hard-fought game to the eventual national champion, North Dakota State. In his second season, Broyles led the Gorillas to a 13-1-1 record and the school's first NCAA Division II national championship. The Mulberry, Kansas native led the team to 11 straight wins to end the season, including a 23-6 victory over Jacksonville State in the ultimate game. In 1992, he guided Pitt State to another unbeaten regular season and a return trip to Florence, Alabama, with a thrilling ride through postseason play.
At the line of scrimmage, Beachy takes it, runs it, and will pitch it outside. He is hit, and did he get in? He didn't make it! He didn't get in! It's over!
The Gorillas' bid for an undefeated season and back-to-back national titles came up just short in the waning seconds in a repeat matchup against Jacksonville State, halting a school record 25-game win streak. His 1995 squad enjoyed a 12-1-1 campaign and a national runner-up finish, while his 2004 national runner-up team featured one of the most prolific offenses in the history of college football. Overall, Broyles guided the Gorillas to the NCAA postseason 15 times in his 20-year tenure. He compiled 19 career postseason wins, the second highest total among Division II coaches all time.
First thing Coach Broyles did for me was he got me a new pair of shoulder pads. As a junior, I was wearing the same pads I wore in high school, and he came in as defense coordinator, took care of me as a player. He was the kind of coach when he first came here on staff as a D coordinator that you wanted to play for. He would have you over for dinner to his house. He would bring different groups in, different groups of players, and sit down with his kids and Helen, and we'd have dinner. And he was a guy that you really want to go through the wall for as a player. And certainly that was greatly appreciated. And he's kind of could get you pretty fired up to play. Whether it be giving you a forearm shiver to the chest or just talking to you and being positive and encouraging.
When I think about Coach Broyles, you think about this calm, cool, and collected guy most of the time, but then when he gets hot, he gets really, really hot. And it was something that as a team, you could kind of feed off of. Some of the memories that stick with me is just before the game, how stoic he was, laying down before the game, and then how heated he got on the sidelines. It just, it was something to feed off of as a team.
Broyles was honored three times as the NCAA Division II National Coach of the Year, from the American Football Coaches Association in 1991, from Shutt Sports in 2004, and from Liberty Mutual in 2008. On October 23rd, 1999, he became the first coach in the 20th century to record his 100th victory in less than 10 full seasons. And the next week, he passed his former mentor Charlie Finley as the winningest head coach in MIAA history. On September 29, 2001, Coach Broyles passed his former college coach, Carney Smith, as Pitt State's all-time winningest head coach. And in 2004, he became the first MIAA coach to lead his program to 9 conference championships. During his 20-year tenure, Broyles coached 91 first-team All-MIAA players, 75 NCAA Division II All-Americans, and 2 winners of the Harlan Hill Trophy. He also coached 164 players who earned MIAA academic honors and 16 academic All-American honorees.
He's always been looked at as the big man, but he's got a softer side to him. He's got a kind heart, especially in terms of our university of Pittsburgh State, and that kind heart shows up in how he cares about his staff, not only in football but in the university athletic programs, and how much he cares and takes care of the students that come through him. So I've always appreciated that, those kinds of characteristics that Coach has.
As you all know, Coach Broyles likes to tell Bud Mercer stories. What Coach doesn't know is that we like to tell Chuck Broyles stories. Like the time that we were in the airport trying to rent a car, and Coach Broyles was getting a little frustrated because the gal kept asking him, "Do you want insurance?" "No, I don't want insurance." "Do you want this?" "Do you want that?" "Well, this is going to cost how much?" And finally, Coach Broyles just asked her, "Well, how much is it going to cost if we don't bring the vehicle back?" And that's what Coach Broyles liked to call reversing the charges.
Pitt State football has stood the test of time. Through the heartaches and pains of hard times, as well as the thrills of victory and the blood, sweat, and tears it took to achieve them, so too will the legacy of Pitt State football's Chuck Broyles.
Coach Broyles, congratulations on your induction into the Hall of Fame. Very deserving. Your career, unparalleled, and just happy that I was a part of it. You had a lot of great influence on me, which is still with me to this day.
What a great honor for Chuck to be inducted into the Pittsburgh State Hall of Fame. No one that I can think of more deserving. I'm excited for him being inducted in there. He epitomizes Pitt State football, which is a very special brand of football, special program, and Chuck has been involved with them for many, many years as a player, as an assistant coach, and a head coach. And, I think that Pitt State football stands for a lot of things, and Chuck Royal stands for all those things. So, congratulations, big guy. Proud of you.
Coach Broyles, congratulations to you on your induction into the Pittsburgh State University Hall of Fame. After being in the NCAA Division II for just 2 years, you led this university to a national championship. How outstanding is that? I personally want to thank you for all you've done for me and for allowing me to grow as a coach. I owe a lot to you. And I think the number one reason that Coach Broyles should be inducted into the Pittsburgh State University Hall of Fame is because of his loyalty. He's always been extremely loyal to this university. He always told our coaching staff, "We're going to do what's best for Pittsburgh State." And that's what he has done. Coach, congratulations.
Charlie, thanks for your loyalty. Thanks for your love for Pittsburgh State University. And I want you to know how much I appreciate you and what you meant to this university. So congratulations on a well-deserved honor.
Please join us in welcoming Chuck Broyles to the Pitt State Athletics Hall of Fame.
Mantle one time and then Ian Whitey Ford, and you've all heard the story, I'm sure some of us have. and they stayed out late at night. Had to drink a little too much. Hung over the next day, and he knew that he had the day off. Casey Stengel gave him the day off. So Mickey Mantle was curled up over in the corner, hungover, sick, and they called on him to pinch hit in the eighth inning. He got up, he went up and hit a home run, came back to the dugout and gave him a standing ovation, and tipped his hat and went back and curled up and going to sleep. And, you know, take another time. He goes, if they knew how hard that was, they'd still be clapping. And 42 years of coaching, not at Pittsburgh State, but in my career has been, you know, very rewarding. And Mark, my son, who's sitting over here, said, I said, I need to give you a pair of sunglasses for the game today because it's going to be bright. And he goes, won't you dig out those ones you used to wear in the game? God, I love those. I love you. You know, I could hardly see that the great big old glasses, and they're just regular glasses, but they would turn polarized during the day, and so I had those sunglasses on. And as I go through and, you know, listen to all the things that are said about you, and, you know, it's a lot of good stuff. And as I watched Justin play and Leslie, you know, those are just, you know, really, really good stuff. And then Albert Schmidt, and Albert was right. Some of those defensive players, when they used to talk to Albert, I'd see him, and we used to have what's called team tackling, and Albert would be 10th in line, and I'd see where he's going. They grab somebody and put them in front of them. And did you see that? On one of those team pictures, that really good-looking number 72 down the front row, that was me. I was a senior when Albert was a freshman. And I had brown hair. And the pictures on the game program, if you get the game program today, when I came here, I didn't have one gray hair. And it took 4 years. 2 years to win the national championship, 4 to not have any brown hair. Just the way it is. Just the way it is. And I always have, you know, lots and lots of fond memories. We just do. You know, like Leslie said, what stays, we say here stays here. Oh my gosh, 22 years of staff meetings and players and you know, Kendall, and, you know, he can just, you know, the team that was here when I got here was very dedicated, strong, but took a lot of what do you call it? High maintenance, a few of them. We talk about our degrees and ISTs. You know, we bring people in here, and you know, all the All Americans, all the All Conference players, academic All Americans, and some of those players. I questioned the validity of my degree once in a while because they came in here not very good students, but left, you know, as college graduates. And it wasn't because I questioned the validity of my degree. It was because of the people that cared for them here at Pittsburgh State and took care of them. And Ronald West, of course, he told me 1 year, said, Coach, I'm going to take you to the promised land. That was in 1990. Next year, you know, we won them all. Well, we didn't win them all, but we won enough to win the national championship. We won the last one. That's the most important thing. But a lot of those guys, and Ronnie, he says, I need a tutor. I said, what do you need? What class do you need two for? All of them. And after the first game, when he dropped one pass and caught 4 more for touchdowns, he had tutors in every game. Sometimes 2. Sometimes just lots and lots of great players, lots and lots of great memories, and his genie who we get to talk about. I didn't mention Oscar while I called it Oscar. I'm down in the hall yesterday. I'm here, Coach! Coach! And what I get, big old hug from Oscar Goodloss, you know. The friendships that you can make, not only with your football players, but the friendships you can make with the people in other sports. And of course, Oscar was one of those kind of people that we all loved. And just lots and lots of, you know, great players through the years. And one of the things that I cherish the most and miss the most is the relationship with the players. You know, when people are talking, see the wife in her eyes, and shoot, when I'm over there watching Fran and John talk about, you know, you get teary-eyed. But, you know, one of the things that Hal and I have done through the years, whether it was at Pittsburgh State or Rolling, we had our boys, we always wanted them around diversity. And whether they were football players from Caldwell, Kansas, or Chicago, black players, white players, yellow players, tall ones, fat ones, skinny ones, nice ones, we have them in our home. Helen used to do the cooking, but she hasn't done it for 20 years. So I do. But we went from really, really nice meals down to just a piece of old steak on the grill and some potatoes and maybe a dessert that I got that was reduced at Dillon's. Gotta stretch that money somehow. And Tim's right, you know, we tried to do it right at Pittsburgh State. We just did. And when I first came here, it was K-A-W-C. Kid will put it on the board, everybody did too. We put it on every scouting report, every travel, whatever it was, we put it on the board before we go out. And it was, you know, it was just simply in this day and age, I can say this because I go and turn my TV on here twice as worse. Kick ass with class. You know? And those are the G-rated shows on TV. That's just what we believe in. And I tell our coaches when we're recruiting, don't sell your soul. It takes a special person to come to Pittsburgh State to play. Now, if they're really, really good, I'll sell mine once in a while. But don't sell your soul. You know, try to find people that will come in here and fit into the community and be loved by the community. Now, one of the things that Helen has done the last couple of years is we lived in a house for 22 years and she sold it. And then we moved. But we did it in the 1st of August when all the players, all the coaches are in 2-a-day. So where's all my friends? They're at practice. So she about killed me. I don't think it was a plan. I don't think it was intentional at all. But we moved. And then we decided we're going to move again. So we now have another house. And trying to put her things, our things, in and around that house, it becomes a challenge and very unique, but she does a great job. Women, you may not be able to understand what I'm going to say here, but guys can. If you go into a public bathroom in a restaurant or whatever it is, and you're a guy and you're standing before a urinal, you look up and it says, State Farm Insurance Discounts, and you're sitting there going to the bathroom reading stuff that's up there. You know, what a great advertising ploy. I mean, guys have seen it. We all see it. I don't know women if they put them on the floor or whatever. But Helen's got this plaque that's right there where I'm going to go to the bathroom. And it says, Coach Broyles reaches the century mark. And the letters are less than 16 inches tall. So here I am. Trying to trying to read all the things that are on there. And it says so many good things about me, so many nice things about me. And you know what? So I took it down this morning and read it, wrote down this. And it's talking about, not only was Coach Broyles got won more games before anyone, and I always tell my sons and whatever, won more games in the history of football before anyone else did. You know how many people that's ahead of me? None. The only one. Damn. All right. Yeah, we have $10 to go to McDonald's or whatever it is. You know. But I wrote down, and they're saying all these nice things. I said, obviously, they quoted me, obviously, this is a tribute to our football program and the hard work of our players and coaches. It's also a statement of the dedication from former players and all the coaches and staff that's gone before us. You know, and Tim, I've talked lots of times. Pittsburgh State and Lane Lord and Kevin, it's doable here. It just is. It's doable. It's doable in basketball. It's doable in football. It's doable in the classroom. Because you know why? It's been done. It's been done. And Tim right now, he's winning games. This guy the other day said, you know, I bet. Girls do good, but I bet you don't want to do too good, do you? Because you're not coaching anymore. Well, I should have backhanded him, but it was in, it's in the grocery store, and you can't hit people in the grocery store. But I get to thinking about those things. Why wouldn't I want the girls to go? I raised those guys. I should have taken Xanax, but I didn't. You know, Tim's been, I've been trying to do since that I hired him. I'd be disappointed. He knows how to work. Carl Roth, I coached him. David Weimers was a graduate assistant. And John Pierce was a GA. And then this goes on up. Steve Rampey, now we didn't, he went out and hired him, but he came to our football camps. Hell, he didn't win a state championship until he came to Chuck Broyles' camp. Stellar career. And when people, my friends, any of them would win a national championship, I'd send them a note and say, it's yours. No one can ever take it away from you. And that's, you know, that's like my career. It's mine. Dr. Brian, I'll always cherish these words. He's given me lots of good advice through the years, but we would sit around as athletic director for 14 years and was president for 10. We would talk to Bob Retzlaff, who was the academic vice president, all around the room, whether it was Jim Alshon and then other people, and how important this school year is. It's terribly important. Academics look like we got enough seats for them to get in. You know, credit our productions up. You know, John Patterson, you've done another great job of taking money from athletics and putting it over there. But managing the business part of the university. Because everyone, what a great team. Dr. Scott, I'm sure, has those kind of meetings and whatever that goes on. Now, I don't know if Dr. Scott turns to Jim Johnson, but Dr. Bryant would always turn to me and say, and Charlie, you just win 10 games this year, everything's going to go really, really good here. That's all you got to do. Just win 10 games. Because football at Pittsburgh State, when we win, which is most of the time, makes people happy. I bet lots and lots of people say lots and lots of good things about me. And then I also have a drawer over here at my desk that I kept through the years that without a doubt, most of them are signed loyal guerrilla fan. But some of them started out, why in the hell did you hire Jerry Keel? Offensive coordinator from a high school, and now you expect him to do good in college. Well, I really did expect him to do good. And, you know, now he's the head coach at the University of Minnesota. He did pretty good. And then when we moved him back to defensive coordinator, and then I get those notes in, why don't you wear a headset? You've let this program get plumb away from you. And that was like in 1999, you know. But for the most part, it's things that you take with you and things that you cherish and cherish, you will. And then those other ones, you know, I've often thought that some people aren't happy unless you're miserable. And if you coach, it's very, very personal. And you're miserable enough, so if you have an inkling to send Tim any of those loyal guerrilla fans, don't do it. Just congratulate them and cheer for them and whatever. And I don't know who's picking up the slack for Helen hollering at the officials, but now that I sat with her, I tell her, be quiet. Well, I was going to start by saying, I'd just like to trace a little bit of my history. And I was going to start out by saying, you know, like, I was born in 1947 to Carl and Helen Broyles. And because of time restraints, we'll probably just need to flip ahead to the game this afternoon and leave everything out in between to say thank you. Anyway, as Father Tom, who's been a friend of mine for years, I've heard him speak on several occasions, and I really like this line. Okay, I'm up here to talk, and you're out there to listen. If you finish before I do, just raise your hand. I don't see any hands, so I guess I'll go on. And I always say, you know, my tenure at Pittsburgh State is long time. And I look at the back of that program I was going to bring up. And in 1988, Coach Fran and I put together the Hall of Fame in 1988. You know, we called around, we got the bylaws, what Rolla was doing. So that was the first class, the first year I came here. And I've been fortunate enough to be at every one of them. There have been some great people standing up here, and lots and lots of good things said about Pittsburgh State. And those things will continue, you know, it'll continue. Enrollment's up. Dr. Scott, I guess we got enough chairs for everybody to sit in. John, we got any money left? Yeah. Hopefully. If not, Brad needs to get out there and raise some more. But that's just the way it is, and it'll continue to be that way because people in this room just like you and support this university and whatever. Another one of my accomplishments is that Phil Scott, about 5 years ago, bench press the bar on the bench press, and it weighs 45 pounds, and it's hard to do. How much you benching now, Phil?
245.
He'd run one lap around the track, and now he runs 5Ks, right?
Yeah.
5Ks. In the summertime, he'd run a football team, and he'd pass the gasser test, you know. And so he has served us well as an inspiration and dedication in that weight room. So Phil, those guys, you know, they love you to death. You gonna go again sometime?
Oh,
Well, you know what? So am I. We'll see y'all over. Thank you very much.